Okay, are you ready? I think there are some more people join today. Maybe the topic make you interesting. And personally, I always have some interest in the music and the sound. And if you know my bio a little bit, that before I become a monk, I really love singing. But now as a monk, I cannot sing, you know. I always make some joke that, oh, now I cannot sing one song. Samarang, samarang. Yeah, that's the only song that I can sing. And maybe if you hear the chanting and it sounds like a music to your ear, that might be another song when we chant Thammajak, right? Eva me sutang eka. It's a chanting, but if you listen, it's a sound. And music is a sound that have different tone. I always amazed by music that is kind of, you know, not less than E equal MC square in science. But who invent music? Like what, who is the first musician in the history? I'm curious to know, like, who make the first sound that make people smile and feel hopeful? Yeah, yeah. If anyone quite expertise, like have some expertise on that area, please chat in the chat room. That I'm curious because I, you know, music make people move. Music make people laugh. Music unite people. And my teacher, he used music a lot. Actually, he has the team who do all the instrumenting, but he wrote like a poem and he composed so many songs. And you might hear those songs before also. So let's explore this music and art area in Buddhism and let's see how we make Buddha teaching joyful, inviting, like a, not like a, oh, that's a ancient scripture and then we're gonna have 2 hours discussing. Yeah, we can have like a wisdom that very authentic, but also lively at the same time that can bring more people, especially young people. Yeah. Okay, let's see what I found and I have some nice video also to show you. Okay, I will share my screen. See. Okay, as I mentioned, that today it might be the very first time that I link music and Buddhism and Buddha teaching. I actually, you know, through the event or webinar, I use different song also to show you how we can interact with Buddha teaching with more joy. But this is like a, the real discussion on this music thing. I hope it's not the last time. Yeah, different instructor also can bring this kind of interesting topic. Okay, let's review this. That you do agree this or not? I hear this first time when I join one of the yoga festival in outside Los Angeles, and one guy he like really used music for meditation, and he said, "Oh, venerable, yeah, do you know about this? That music is the only thing that can enter your system, your mind, your heart without your permission." Now, if you have some argument, you think, oh, I agree with this or I disagree. But when music come in and, you know, when you enjoy it, there's no discussion, I'm gonna enter you or you allow or not. It just come in, right? If you agree with Emmanuel Zhao. He's an African artist. If you agree with him, he's Thai number one. If you disagree, Thai number two. That other thing you will, you know, review on it. But one is the sound or the tone that made you feel good. You just come in and then you flow toward that message. Yeah. And okay, in my research, and if you're quite aware about how Buddha found the middle way, it's through the sound. You heard about that? You heard about the string? Too loose, too tight? Yeah. If you heard about this thing before, that, oh, that string too loose, too tight, tight number three. Yeah. But if you never heard about that string, tight number four. To make it easier for everyone to understand, and then today in the Q&A, we can discuss on that part. I try to find that scene in the video that I'm going to show you in the Pali Canon. But it seems like in the middle way part, it's not written there, but it's what written in the commentary part. Commentary is the enlightened one after the Buddha time. Explain, yeah, those details in the original Pali Canon. Yeah, but this is the scene that you might know about this, the little Buddha, Kinu Reef. And that's the most known version of the Buddha on the movie. So let's go back 1,000 years and see that scene, and we can come back for some discussion. Oh, sorry. Stop share. Okay. Gonna show the video.
For 6 years, Siddhartha and his followers lived in silence and never left the forest. For drink, they had rain. For food, they had a grain of rice or a broth of mud or the droppings of a passing bird. They were trying to master suffering by making their minds so strong they would forget about their bodies. Then, one day, Siddhartha heard an old musician on a passing boat speaking to his pupil.
If you tighten the string too much, it will snap. And if you leave it too slack, it won't play.
Suddenly, Siddhartha realized that these simple words held a great truth, and that in all these years he had been following the wrong path. Thank you. A village girl offered Siddhartha her bowl of rice. And for the first time in years, he tasted proper food. But when the ascetics saw their master bathing and eating like an ordinary person, they felt betrayed, as if Siddhartha had given up the great search for enlightenment.
Come and eat with me.
You have betrayed your vows, Siddhartha.
You have given up the search.
We can no longer follow you.
We can no longer learn from you.
To learn is to change. The path to enlightenment is in the middle way. It is the line between all opposite extremes. If I can reach enlightenment, may this board float upstream.
Middle way was the great truth Siddhartha had found, the path he would teach to the world.
Okay, I give a big, big hand to this good word. Anyone have seen this movie before? Yeah, if you seen before, can you type number five? Number five. Yeah, it's old movie, long time ago, but it's the most known, you know, Buddha's story in the whole world. You know, actually, if you now you study with me, and also it's more like Vajrayana tradition of Buddha. They have Lama, they find reincarnation. Yeah, if like a Theravada director gonna do little Buddha, might have a different tone. However, the main thing is the same. Four Noble Truth, that the self-tormentation and then sensual pleasure as a prince, is the same line. So I think that's very cool. And I saw this a long time ago. And I'm happy that the Hollywood and the art really touched on this. And then more people, oh, what is this, right? So let's continue. Let's see. So this is the actual word, that was written in the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta, which consider it like the Dhamma constitution. Like without this one, we cannot expand to a very wide scope of Buddha teaching. So the central teaching of the Buddha is how we can overcome suffering. And that suffering is not just physical, mental, emotional, even spiritual. Who am I? Why we are here together in this planet? And what is, you know, that big why? Yeah. And Siddhartha really want to know what's going on and why people in cycle. So in the movie, you see Keanu Reeves try to convince, right, the five ascetic who follow him, that, oh, he didn't betray his vow. He found a way. He found a way. But they just walk away. Like, oh, you are the loser. You not keep your vow. But this picture is after that event. So Siddhartha enlightened, and then he returned after his enlightenment to that five ascetics. And at first, the five ascetics did not respect and agree, but Siddhartha become Buddha already. He start to speak something that ascetic, wow, we never hear this thing before. And then every one of them, you know, they cultivate so many practice to be enlightened. So they sit down and then listen. And then Siddhartha said, Bhikkhu, which means monk, these two extreme should not be followed. What to? The pursuit of sensual indulgence and the pursuit of self-mortification without veering toward either of these extreme, the Tathagata, which means the Buddha also. That's another name of the Buddha. Tathagata means the one who has gone forth, like a went to Nirvana, has awakened to the middle way, which give rise to vision and knowledge, which lead to peace, insight, enlightenment, and Nirvana, Buddha. You know, this is ancient. This is more than 2,500 years old. But it's timeless. In Pali, it said akaliko, that Buddha teaching is timeless. And if you're going to look back at any period of history, it's always the moment that someone has a very extreme idea about something, recess, religion, or this is the only answer. This is the only way. And do not listen to some other, like a culture thought or something that different, that make a big trouble. Yeah. So I truly believe that the middle way is so relevant to good life, and it's so relevant to good family, to good company, to good society, even a better world, that we need the middle way. And I'm delighted that now more and more Western scholars start to look at the middle way, not just for spiritual practice, but for policy level. You can research differently, the middle way economy, the middle way policy, or you will see many ones of them that, wow, they now kind of desperate a little bit from so many thinker that, wow, we keep fighting. So they look to the Buddha more and more. Now they look into that area. I do have one evidence that in another part in Kutaka Nikaya, that this is Buddha teaching to another enlightened one called Sona Golivisa. Yeah, he also enlightened one. Yeah, you can Google him, research later. There are many enlightened ones in the Buddha time, but there are 80, it's called 80 foremost monk, the monk who are excellent in each area. For example, Sariputta, he's a foremost monk on wisdom. So Buddha said, if I'm not at that place, Sariputta can teach instead of me. His wisdom level is foremost among all the enlightened ones. Even they are enlightened, but they have their expertise in different area. Yeah, in Pali, you term Eta Thakha, which means the expert or the foremost. So Na Golivisa, this monk, he's enlightened, but he's a foremost monk on austere practice. What is that? He very disciplined. Like he, like a away from all the sensual pleasure and practice for many days, many months. and become known among all monks. If you want the austere practice, let go from all sensual pleasure. Go to Sona Golivisa. He the most expert one. But interestingly, yeah, if you will research in the Pali Canon, Sona Golivisa, he from like a well-to-do family in those days, and he become musician. But in Pali Canon, it looked like a, they call Sita, S-I-T-A. Yeah, similar to guitar in the modern day. It might look like what we see in the movie scene, like a Sita prayer. So he's a musician, like a good family, and then a musician. But one, he become a monk. Interesting, he very much into music and art. But when he become a monk, he would like to go to another extreme. He do walking meditation whole day. He do not eat at all. And then it's more to even become a monk under the Buddha. But he have tendency toward self-tormentation. Like a, I will not enjoy food too much, or very strict kind of. And it's written in Pali Canon that he walk bare feet on the rough earth, rough ground, like have a rock or anything, until the blood come out from his feet. Like, oh, I will endure. They're like, oh, if I can overcome this pain, enlightenment is coming, something like that. Then he cannot walk with his feet, so he crawl. Yeah, austere practice. One day, you know, maybe his karma is completed. Buddha come to see him, and Buddha know he's a musician. And this is something excellent about the Buddha. He have the content, but he know the context very well. Like, oh, this person, this is the best teaching for this person. If he meet the businessman, he talk business language. He met with the musician, the former musician who become a monk. Buddha asked, oh, Sona Golivisa, what happened when you tune your instrument too tightly? Buddha asked. Sona Golivisa replied, the string break. And what happened when you string it too loosely? When it's too loose, no sound come out. The musician means Sona Golivisa answered, the string that produce a tuneful sound is not too tight and not too loose. That said, the Buddha is hard to practice, not too tight and not too loose. Yeah. After that teaching, Sona Golivisa, it like a, oh, what I have done many days that not enlightened yet, is too tight. I need to fix it. I need to find a way. You know, there's some modern day challenge. And we can discuss more about the music and also Buddhism and how to practice their real life. Not everyone born at the same speed. Yeah. Yeah, if you born like a bicycle style and in different culture, go bicycle is fine. You need to go to Formula One style. Yeah. But some people born in the Formula One speed. Too tight, too loose. For each person is not the same. And this is a challenge. Yeah. Oh, some people, you know, so relaxed. And they get into another culture that, you know, even in America, yeah, I went to different places in America, different city, different speed. Right? Even walking, even and they feel like this is okay. So the middle way is universal, but the middle way also personal. Yeah, and that is something that you think about it, that have the middle way in mind, but content and context and how we can personalize that to suit our speed. That, oh, this is my string. This is too tight, this is too loose. It's not the string of other person. Yeah. I have one kind of, I would call like a innovative way how my teacher used the music and cartoon to teach the middle way to kids. After the video, we come back for Q&A. Yeah, we can learn the middle way in a very interesting and smiling way. Okay, let's move it. Okay, give a big, big hand to the wonderful cartoon. You like it? Yeah, the middle way for everyone. I think not only kids like cartoon, adults also like cartoon. We pass the microphone to Vera for our Q&A.